Good afternoon, everybody. Hope y'all have had a enjoyable and relaxing morning here in Suwannee. I know I have, and I'm about to get started doing a little guitar influences workshop. And this is my first time ever doing a workshop, ever performing a workshop, so y'all are in for, I was going to say a treat, but that's not quite the word. It's, you're in for a nice experiment, because this is going to be 100% improvised. But I've been thinking about it for a few weeks now, you know, what I was going to talk about during this workshop. And so what I'm going to do for y'all is I'm going to talk about my influences as far as in bluegrass and old time, western swing, blues, jazz. And I'm going to give you some demonstrations of how I apply that to my playing. I'm going to talk about some of my heroes and talk about, you know, how their playing might have changed the genre of music, and how it influenced it, and how it's still influencing people like me today. And y'all are either here for one of two reasons. Either one, you've heard of me before and you wanted to come check it out, which I hope that's the case. But if not, the other one is you just need something good to do and something to fill time. So I hope I'm going to fill your time with some fun stuff today. Thank y'all for hanging out with me. This first tune I'm going to start off playing is one of my own tunes. And the reason I'm going to start off with one of my own songs first is so that I can go back later on and point out certain instances or certain things in my song where you'll be able to hear the influence of the other artists. So this song right here is off my first record, which just came out in January. It's called Colby T. Helms' Tales of Misfortune. And we have some copies at the merch booth, so if y'all enjoy this, go get you a record or a CD down there. But this song has several different styles of music that influenced it. When we first started playing this tune, it started off real bluegrassy, and we had Stuart in the band at the time, who's the banjo player and plays bass. And we used to do blazing fast. I mean, just, you know, super fast. And then he stopped playing with us for a while, and we started getting into more swingy stuff. And then when I went to record it, my buddy Brendan Ernst came down from Philadelphia, and he's an amazing jazz and ragtime pianist. I mean, just absolutely blows your mind. I mean, he's one of those guys that he's like an alien. He doesn't even seem human. But anyway, he came down there, and I said, you know, I want to add some ragtime piano to this. And he said, well, sure, let's try it. And I got my buddy Billy Hurt to play the fiddle on it. And so the track ended up taking a whole new turn, and it's got this real nice swingy bounce to it. And I'm going to be talking about swing rhythm later, a little bit later in this workshop. But this was called First Snow, and the melody's based off of an old fiddle tune called the Poke River Blues. This is a old Justice and Jarvis tune from back in the 1920s. And the original tune would go something kind of like this. That's about how the original tune would go. So I love that melody, and I switched it up and created this tune right here. It's called First Snow. We Well, the winds are howling on the ridge tonight. Along the sea, such a beautiful sight. Drink a little something that'll get you feeling right, cause outside the railing's froze. Well, I'm gonna take a drift down a long back road. Come to a cabin with one ton door. Smoke rolling out that old wood stove, and it's lit by candlelight. Well, I'm gonna see my baby on the very first snow. Sit around, talk about what we know. Sipping on whiskey and a cup of Joe, getting higher than the national debt. Mine wood floor's creaking beneath my bed, and all blood's running to my head. Thinking about what my mama said, and I'm trying to forget. Something about a snowfall makes me smile. Pipe dream makes it all worthwhile. Hope my truck makes the extra mile up that ridgeline road. Well, it could be hunting, could be trapping, could be fishing, and I should be napping. Instead, I find myself mapping my way back home to you. Well, I'm gonna see my baby on the very first snow. Sit around, talk about what we know. Sipping on whiskey and a cup of Joe, getting high on the national debt. Wood floor's creaking beneath my bed, and all blood's running to my head. Thinking about what my mama said, and I'm trying to forget. From that spastic dream, something was wet, so it seems. Something about loving and nicotine that will make your thoughts go wild. But I'll get up, shower, comb my hair, go to work in despair. That damn Sandman did me wrong when I went to sleep. Well, I'll get up, shower, comb my hair, go to work in despair. Damn Sandman did me wrong when I went to sleep. That's the first note for you there. That's a fun little tune. Like I said, it started out when we first wanted to record the song. We did it like blazing, like. But then when we had that ragtime piano to it, you know, it really slowed it down and got that swingy groove, you know, and it turned it into a whole new song. So. You might ask, so why do you play all these runs, and why are you using a thumb pick? So the reason I'm doing that is I'd like to talk a little bit about the thumb pick, and the old-time guitar players usually played with thumb picks, and I wondered why. I wanted to know, you know, what's the history behind that? One of my favorite old-time bands is called Get Tanner and the Skillet Lickers, and They were really famous back in the late 20s and 30s, early 30s. And the guitar player for that band, his name is Riley Puckett. And Riley Puckett was blind. And there's no, obviously, any video of him ever playing. But there's, of course, many recordings. And when you see pictures of him with him holding his guitar, he's always holding his hand like how I'm holding it right now. He has his fingers pressed down, and he has these fingers curled on the bottom strings, and he has a thumb pick, or he has his thumb resting near the top. And I wondered, since there's no videos of him playing, did he play with his thumb pick and stroke down with his finger like Maybelle Carter? They call that Carter style, like something like this. That would be Maybelle Carter style. So I didn't know if he played like that or if he played something like this. But I found this old picture from the 1920s, and it had a very, very distant relative of mine that I never knew about, or we were just looking through a stack of old pictures. And it was from 1898 or something like that. And it was in Roanoke, Virginia, near where I'm from. I'm from southwestern Virginia. And it was a band. And this relative of mine was in this band, and he played guitar. So I found him in the picture, and the way he held his hand was just like Riley Puckett. He was holding it with his two fingers posted up like this on the bottom. He had these other his other two fingers here on the bottom two strings and his thumb resting on the top. And I realized that in the old parlor days, back when before these big old dreadnought, these large-sized dreadnought guitars came out, they all had these small parlor guitars. You know, this is before bluegrass and every and country music really took off, you know, obviously. And so they played in areas where there was no need to have a dreadnought at that time. In other words, it makes sense that he was playing like that, playing in that style, because that was very common at the time. I did not know that until I did some research and ended up finding that picture, and it proved my theory that that is how he was playing. So I'm going to demonstrate a little Dark Town Strutter's Ball for you, which is an old tune that was a jazz standard back in the 20s, and the Skillet Lickers do a version of it, which I think is awesome. If you really think about it in context, the 1920s jazz was the big thing, right? And so it's very crazy to think about an old-time band covering us. It'd be like an old-time band today covering the newest Justin Bieber song or something, you know? And so it's really funny to think about it like that. These guys are playing old-time music, but they're covering a new song of the day. This is a really fun one to play. It's called Dark Town Strutter's Ball, and I'm going to do some of these old guitar runs that Riley Puckett used to do, or something similar. I try not to ever copy one lick directly, but more or less capture the essence of the player. And this is a fun little tune. It's about going out to your favorite dance and shimmying with all the fancy folks, you know? Some good news, honey, an invitation to a high brown ball. It's a very swell affair, cause all the high folks will be there. Well, I'll wear my high silk hat and my frocking coat. You wear your pants gown and your new silk shawl, no doubt about it, babe. We'll be the best dressed in the hall. I'll be down to get you with the taxi, honey. You better be ready about a 8:30. Now, dear, don't be late. I want to be there when the band starts playing. Remember when we get there, honey, a little two-step will have them all. Gonna dance on both of my shoes when I get them jelly roll blues tomorrow night at the Dark Town Strutter's Ball. High-toned neighbors, an exhibition of the baby doll. Each one will do their best just to outclass all the rest. There'll be dancers from every foreign land, the classic buck wing and the wooden clog, and we'll win that $50 prize when we get out and walk the dog. I'll be down to get you with the taxi, honey. You better be ready about 8:30. Now, dearie, don't be late. I want to be there when the band starts playing. Remember when we get there, honey, little two-step will have them all. Gonna dance on both of my shoes when I get them jelly roll blues tomorrow night at the Dark Town Strutter's Ball. Well, I'm down have to get you with the taxi, honey. You better be ready about a 8:30. Now, dearie, don't be late. I want to be there when the band starts playing. Remember when we get there, honey. Little two-step, we'll have them all. Gonna dance up both of my shoes when I get them jelly roll blues. Tomorrow night at the Dogtown Strutters Ball. Thank y'all so much. It's one of my favorite songs to play. It's just like got that vibe to it that just puts a smile on your face every time. Thinking about people dancing to that in the 1920s is pretty cool. So that leads me to my next topic, and I'm gonna take y'all through the years now. So that old-timey rhythm play, and the reason that it came about is because there was no, you know, the old-time bands a lot of times didn't have a bass player. I mean, there was no stand-up bass. No, you know, it was like a kind of a, back in those days, you know, a stand-up bass, usually only jazz bands or big orchestras had them. You know, your typical country boys didn't go out and invest in buying a bass. So the guitar player is left with all the burden to carry that bass rhythm. And if you notice in my playing, I do an alternating and walking bass all the time with my guitar. I can't ever just strum the guitar hardly because it's just built into me now. I had to play for years with my band with no bass. And so, you know, I had to take into account these old-time rhythm guys and apply it to my playing. Of course, when you're, real quick, I'm gonna grab something. I applied to my playing, and so when I got into swing stuff and got into Western swing, that was a big help that I had already, you know, learned a bunch about alternating bass, because when you're playing Western swing, you have to keep that in mind. You have to do alternating bass, but then you have to keep in mind the whole rest of the chord too, because you have all these shell chords, they call them, which are closed position chords. And in Western swing, that's very, very important. So I'm gonna do a little demonstration of some Western swing for you, and do, and I'm gonna show you how I apply some of that walking bass that I, you know, y'all saw me do it with the Darktown Strutters Ball. And it's, so that song was also played by Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys, which I'm a huge, huge, huge fanatic of, you know, early Western swing and Bob Wills. And they do that song too, but they don't do the verses. They just do the chorus, which was very common in the 40s. A lot of these people started taking, in the 30s too, these old jazz songs had long intros, and then they had these really catchy choruses. So anytime these guys would go out and jam, let's say you want to go to a jazz jam, they just stopped playing the weird long intros in the beginning. They just went straight to the choruses, and they just like, all right, we're going to jam over the chorus of it. And so Darktown Strutters Ball is one of those songs that happened to. So if you were to play this in Western swing, you have a nice big juicy shell chord like this. And it would be something like this. Something like that. So, you know, trying to do that, applying that, thank y'all very much, applying that to your playing is huge. So we do a song, we did it yesterday in our set, called Ding Dong Daddy from Dumas, and it's a old Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys tune. And I love that tune because it's a great one to demonstrate that kind of a thing. But when you think about old time and you think about Western swing, which are two completely different genres of music, and then you think about applying them together and mixing them, you get this really weird like combo of flavors. And you take people like Jimmy Rogers, who had that same style of playing, you know, that I just did with the old time. You know, he used the thumb pick, and he would, you know. ¶¶ that type of thing. I'm gonna do a song called Peach Picking Time in Georgia. And it's a pretty standard song. You might have heard it before, but I'm gonna play this song and try to demonstrate going back and forth between this Western swing rhythm and this old time rhythm. You know, lots of people have done this song, and usually they do it one way or another. But I'm gonna try to throw a little bit of both in there and see what y'all think. The old Jimmy Rogers tune. Well, it's peach picking time in Georgia. It's apple picking time in Tennessee. Cotton picking time in old Mississippi. And everybody picks on me. Well, it's roundup time in Texas. The cowboys making whippy. And way down south in old Alabama, it's gal picking time to me. Yoodley, ooh, yoodley, ooh, yoodley, the bluegrass in old Kentucky, and Virginia's where we do that swing. Carolina, now I'm coming back to you for the wedding in the spring. Arkansas, I hear you calling. Oh, I know I'll be there soon. Well, we're gonna do a little bit of picking beneath that Ozark moon. Yoodley, ooh, yoodley, yoodley, Pickanese pick the cotton. Oh, that's when I'll pick the ring. I'll go to town, pick out a little gown for that wedding in the spring. I hope that preacher knows his business. Well, I know he can't fool me. Well, it's peach picking time in Georgia. It's gal picking time to me. Thank you. Well, when it's peach picking time in Georgia, it's apple picking time to me. Oh, is it now? Way down in old Mississippi, nobody's picking on me. I said it's roundup time in Texas, and the cowboys making whippy. So way down south in old Alabama, it's gal picking time to me. Yoodle, ooh, yoodle, ooh, yoodle, ooh. Thank y'all so much. Such a fun little tune. So moving right along here. Up next in history, after the Western Swing, another type of a style of guitar playing started to make a popularity comeback. And when I say a comeback, it's not really a comeback because I don't know if it ever really existed at all. There's a very influential guitarist named Mr. Merle Travis, and he changed everything as far as thumb picking goes. One of my favorite blues players, Mississippi John Hurt, you know, he has this very fluid style of finger picking. And I would say that somebody compared my playing to his, and I never even thought about it, considering how much I do study music. I never even, like, compared myself to him. But it takes somebody else, I guess, you know, another brain to figure that out or another perspective. But I never figured it out. But then I started listening to him. I said, in a way, he does, because he plays more fluidly when he's doing his finger pick, and he plays in, like, a fluid, steady manner. Merle Travis has a very sharp bass, and what I mean by a sharp bass is he has a thumping bass line that always is going, you know. Of course, Doc Watson, you know, was a big fan of Merle Travis, and he would play songs like Windy and Warm and Deep River Blues and do it in Travis style, and so he influenced so many people. But I'm going to play a little Merle Travis song here, and this is one that that he was very well known for. It's called the Cannonball Rag. But I can't do it quite like Merle. I do it a lot like Mississippi John. If Mississippi John Hurt were to do it, because I don't have that good thumping bass, you know. I just kind of I just let my hand flow. And so that's advice I give all guitarists: is do what feels natural. As long as it's keeping the melody go, it's keeping the rhythm of the song flowing, then you're doing the right thing, you know. And I met a lot of bluegrass, as my buddy in my band calls it, bluegrass elitists that would say, oh, you're not playing it right, or yada, yada, yada. But as long as you're helping the full band sound, in my opinion, you're doing it right. And so we're going to try a little Travis picking here, a little Cannonball Rag. Thank you. Thank y'all so much. I see some more people filing in. That's awesome. I appreciate y'all spending your time with me today. It means a lot to me because there's so many great acts and, there's multiple people playing at the same time and stuff. So the fact that you took the time to come hang out with me, that truly means a lot. Up next, I'm going to switch gears a little bit and move on down the line. I think it's almost time I start talking about bluegrass rhythm. We've talked about old-time rhythm, and we've talked about Western swing in the 1930s, and we've moved into Merle Travis and some of that picking. It's time we take a look at some of these bluegrass rhythm players and play some bluegrass tunes. Let me tell you a little history lesson about bluegrass. I'm sure y'all have probably heard this story before. So, of course, and Peter Rowland's playing after me, so he could probably tell it a lot better. But bluegrass, was not a genre of music until Bill Monroe and his band made it a thing, And so these other country and western bands or country bands, and then you have your hillbilly type bands, which were a big thing in the 30s, 40s, like J.E. Manor and the Mountaineers and guys like that, it's like almost a hard driving, swingy hillbilly music. And some of my good buddies back in Virginia, Billy Hurt and his band, 5 Mile Mountain Road, they call themselves the Sultans of Swing Billy, which is a pretty cool name, I think. I think they've really captured that essence of the swing and the hillbilly mix. But anyway, he tried to separate his sound from other bands. So he was trying out different instruments, and finally he got to, Earl Scruggs on the banjo, and that's the one that really was pungent. That was the one that took off. So you got to think about national radio at the time. If you heard that for the first time, you would have never heard anything like that before in your life. It'd be like hearing Elvis for the first time if you'd only heard gospel music or something growing up. It was completely out there and just completely new and progressive at the time. And so many people and many bands started copying that sound because they thought it was good. And why wouldn't you want to copy that sound? It's awesome. And bluegrass as a term was used to describe the way that Monroe's band sounded. And so when people say do it back in the day, it'd be like do it bluegrass style, do it like Bill Monroe, in other words. Everybody wanted to have that real high, lonesome sound. And then you have, your old country and western acts that are still doing it the other way. Anyway, the importance of this is that bluegrass, and in essence, what the difference between it and old time is the rhythm, the hard driving rhythm. So he had a lot of great guitar players back in the day. Clyde Moody is one of my favorites. He did a very unique style that's similar to Travis picking, but he didn't have that hard thump. He did, but he would switch back and forth between Travis style, which it was before Merle Travis, and he'd switch back between regular bluegrass rhythm. So he used the thumb pick as well. And when you're playing an old, hard-driving bluegrass song, you need that. And so we're going to talk a little bit about that. I'm going to demonstrate with an old bluegrass tune that a lot of the bluegrass boys have done back in the day. It's called I've Lived a Lot in My Time. And the reason I'm doing this tune is because it perfectly demonstrates some of that old bluegrass rhythm here. I once was a rover, I once was a rambler, I once thought that everything was fine. I once had a mansion and I lived in my glory, I've lived a lot in my time. Well, I fought the grim reaper down in the dark valley, and the sun wouldn't shine. And I've seen the bars of a cold, lonely prison, yes, I've lived a lot in my time. Thank you. I've worked in the coal mines, and I've worked fields of cotton, and I've been down to my last old dime. And I once had a sweetheart, but she proved unfaithful. I've lived a lot in my time. When I fought the grim reaper down in the dark valley, one day the sun wouldn't shine. Well, I've seen the bars of a cold, lonely prison. Yes, I've lived a lot in my time. A little rhythm will be like... I fought the grim reaper down in the dark valley, and prayed when the sun never shines. Yes, I've seen the bars of a cold, lonely prison. Yes, I've lived a lot in my time. Yes, I've lived a lot in my time. Thank y'all. And so that rhythm right there, guys, that rhythm, that hard-driving rhythm, that changed everything, you know? It's like you took the old-time tunes and you put it on steroids. They just took it up a notch, you know? So I'm going to start to move into some of my more, I call it modern, but only because I studied music from the 1920s. You know, I mainly listen to music that's from the 20s to the 70s. I don't listen to much past that, you know. There's something special about that era where great American music was composed. So we'll move into the straight pick, because the thumb pick eventually became a thing of the past. I mean, people play it again now, but there was a long time where the thumb pick went out of style for some reason. Everybody started moving to straight picks. So I'm going to move to a straight pick and show you kind of why that is. Just your average old green Tortex pick here. It's a little bit easier for the versatility when you want to do cross picking, you know, and it's a whole different feel to it, you know. I could play the exact same song and it would be a little bit different. Something like that. And the flat pick allows for you to really dig and get different notes and get different projections. The thumb pick feels like a solid base, a solid foundation for you to hold a band, you know. And it's more comfortable in a way if you're doing long spurts of just playing rhythm backing up a band. But a lot of bluegrass musicians started going to straight pick. And one of the best rhythm players that ever played a straight pick was Mr. Jimmy Martin. And he changed the way that people wanted to play bluegrass rhythm. So most people before him, you know, they would do a lot of the bass stuff. And, you know, like I do. But Jimmy Martin, some people call it lazy, but it's not really lazy. It's just a different type of sound. He had a great band always, and, you know, the Sunny Mountain Boys, and they had a great bass player. There was no need at that point anymore for the guitar to be the bass. And, you know, at that point, you know, bluegrass had kind of really come into its own, you know, and become, you know, separated itself from country music. And so Jimmy had a different approach, and that was to hard drive it and let the other members, you know. So I'm going to try my best not to throw in all these bass runs and stuff, because it's just a habit. It's just in my head now, you know. But we're going to do a Jimmy Martin song. It's called Chalk Up Another One. Now you should get a medal for every broken heart. Think you're ruined because you think you're so smart. Well, I never even had a chance, and now my life is lost. And once more, you've had your fun, you don't care how much it costs. Well, chalk up another one, another broken heart. Chalk up another one, a hot Utah bar. Took me for a fool, my dear, how will I play the part? So chalk up another one, another broken heart. So broken vows and shattered dreams mean little, dear, to you. Cause once you said you love me and now we are through. Well, all is fair in love and war, guess you taught me so. Well, in this crazy game of love, you hitting all time low. Well, so chalk up another one, another broken heart. So chalk up another one, a heart you tore apart. Well, you took me for a fool, my dear, how will I play the part? So chalk up another one, another broken heart. Then do a little flat picking. Well, I have only pity for this evil life you choose. This unfair game you're playing where everyone must lose. Well, I would tell you something one day you won't forget. You added me to your collection and you wish we never met. Well, so chalk up another one, another broken heart. So chalk up another one, a heart you tore apart. You took me for a fool, my dear, how will I play the part? So chalk up another one, another broken heart. So you can see right there, that style rhythm. Thank y'all so much. Really appreciate it. That style rhythm right there, it really changed bluegrass, in my opinion. You know, it like, as a kid, you want to just, and you're learning bluegrass, you just want to play as fast as you can. You know, that I remember when I was first starting out, that's what you wanted to do. And of course, when you're first learning, and still now for me, the faster you play, the slopper you get. And so you lose some of the tone and you lose some of the, you know, the qualities when you play lightning speed, unless you're just a monster like some of these guys that are playing at this festival this weekend, you know. And but, you know, I try to incorporate a little bit of both. But the thing is, it's like cooking, you know. It's like cooking from scratch when you're playing with a band. You just got to take some of these different influences like I've been doing, and you got to apply it when it's needed, you know. It's like an instruction manual. Apply when needed. And sometimes when you think you're dragging, you know, you think the band's dragging, you need a little push. You know, you do one of those Jimmy Martin to kind of push it back up, you know. And then if you think the band is losing time and they can't hear where the chord changes are, that's why I started, you know, really doing all those walking bass runs, because a lot of times we play songs that not everybody in the band knows. But if you give them some kind of a lead, they know where to go. If they're good, you know, if they're good musicians and been playing a long time, they can hear, you know, if I'm playing a song in G. What comes next? You know, you're already anticipating it. So that's why I do that. It's kind of like a little, it's like trainer wheels, really. And that's why I always do that. But it's not just for the other people, it's for myself as well. Because I realized in playing bluegrass at jams a lot, I used to just do the Jimmy Martin style rhythm, not throwing any bass notes. And I realized that I was the one that was either speeding up or slowing down. And I needed a way to ground myself, literally. And so when you throw those bass notes in there, in a way it made guitar playing easier for me in the grand scheme of things, because I have some kind of a root to go back to. So, you know, I started playing rhythm like. And that really grounded myself and helped me, you know, learn how to keep myself and keep my other, you know, players, you know, grounded and solid together. And so it's really fun. Up next, I think I'm going to talk a little bit about actual lead playing. And I'm still, to this day, learning and trying to get better. So I make many mistakes playing, but I'm always trying to do something new, and I'm always trying to, you know, take something in my brain and make it a little bit better, you know, and you gradually, that's how you get better, you know. And so I'm going to show you a little demonstration of some early flat picking. The earliest flat pickers were a guy named Arthur Smith, which he always gets left out of discussions when people talk about, like, I'm in a lot of bluegrass, you know, meme pages and stuff. And he always gets left out of discussions when talking about the first flat pickers. The first flat pickers were really Don Reno, who's very much known for his banjo work, and Arthur Smith. Arthur Smith was a huge, huge fan of Don. Arthur Smith and Don Reno actually made albums together, which I didn't know for the longest time, but they were a fan of each other's work. And, you know, the whole point was that the guitar has such a huge radius of range that why on earth are we not playing solos on these things? You know, in Western swing at the time, you know, in the 30s and 40s, they heard guitar solos on there, and they heard guitar solos in country songs, but there's like all electric guitars. And so they were like, why don't we apply this to, you know, the type of music that we do? So they started working on, you know, trying to be innovative with flat picking. And that's another reason that people move to the flat pick. You know, when you're using a thumb pick, it can be quite difficult to do some of this stuff. I'm going to play a little tune called the Freight Train Boogie. And this really brings it all together, because this has the walking bass that I do, but it also, the solo of the song, the main riff, is basically a walking bass, but you add a double time to it. So the lick to Freight Train Boogie, it's a boogie, so it's a simple boogie, so it's... That's what it is, and it's very, very primitive form. So if you think about it as a guitar player, what if I add double time to that instead of... Add a little. Add a little bit of that to it, and man, you really start to take off. You're like, whoa, what's going on here? So fiddling and guitar Arthur Smith, he came out with this thing called the guitar boogie. And all it was a boogie just about like that, but it was an E. Something like that, and he was doing that, and that came out on the radio in the 1940s, so all these guitar players got inspired, and they wanted to do that, you know. And of course, in blues, you know, people have been taking guitar solos for a long, long time. And of course, like everything in America, I feel like the mass always is a little bit late to the party, you know. And so, you know, by the 1950s, Don Reno had started working on his style. And there's a specific lick that a lot of banjo players will do, and guitar players alike. And I can directly tell you, you can attribute it to Mr. Don Reno. And this lick is a double stop lick, which means it's two strings being played at the same time. And this lick involves sliding into whatever two notes you're about to play. It's something like... Something like that. And I do that a lot in my playing. So I'm going to do a little example of some kind of Don Reno-esque style flat picking, because he hammered it on, man, and he inspired Doc Watson, which is, you know, pretty much the Jesus of flat picking. I mean, he pretty much, you know, drove it home for all types of people, you know, and took it to a international level, whereas some of these other guys, it wasn't quite it wasn't that big, you know. He was inspired heavily by Don Reno, and there's an old recording of them playing together that that got taken down a bunch of times on YouTube. It's a bootleg thing, and somebody snuck a microphone into a tent one time when Doc and Don were playing together, playing two guitars. And anyway, it got taken down a bunch of times, but if you're able to find that video, man, it's so awesome. And Doc is talking about how he can't figure something out on the guitar, so that's why it always gets taken down. I don't know why, but I think it's pretty cool, because he's sitting there actually trying to figure it out with Don. It's really, really cool stuff. But anyway, one of the ones they like to do together was called Don't Let Your Deal Go Down, and I'm going to do a little bit of that for you. Let your deal go down. Don't let your deal go down. Don't let your deal go down till that last gold dollar's gone. Shoes, that dress you wear so fine. She said, I got my shoes from a railroad man, got my dress from a driver in the mines. I said, don't let your deal go down, down, down. Don't let your deal go down. Don't let your deal go down till that last gold dollar's gone. Don't let your deal go down. Don't let your deal go down. Don't let your deal go down, down, down. That last gold dollar's gone. Well, I've been all around this whole wide world, and I've been down to sunny Tennessee. The only place that I hang my hat, well, it's all home sweet home to me. Yeah, well, don't let your deal go down. Don't let that deal go down. Don't let that deal go down till that last gold dollar's gone. A little Don Reno-esque, you know, he really hammered into it, and if you listen to his banjo playing, it sounds a lot like that, you know, because he took a guitar player's approach to the banjo, and he took a banjo player's approach to the guitar, which is something very unique and inspiring. I got about 20 more minutes, so the next few minutes I'm going to talk about cross-picking. If you notice, I do a lot of cross-picking, too. That's kind of the thing I got into in high school, and the last 5 years I've been trying to get better and better and better and better at it, and there's multiple styles of cross-picking. So first I want to talk about shuffler style. He was the first guy that really started doing that. And I don't know this for sure, but I'd like to think that a lot of them got inspired by the auto harp. Of course, the Carter family and Mother Maybelle Carter was a huge influence on making the auto harp a popular instrument. And my grandmother actually played the auto harp as well as the piano. And she was from southern West Virginia, Monroe County, and grew up in the 1920s and 30s, singing on the radio, lived through the Great Depression. And she went to Concord College in West Virginia. And when she got there, she goes to do music as a major, and they handed her sheet music, and she didn't know how to read it. She had played by ear her whole life. But she learned anyway, and she ended up graduating from that school. And she was a pianist all her life in the church and everything, but she loved to improvise, and she loved jazz, and loved to play those old standards and meld them and mix them. And it's funny, she made a big tape of a bunch of songs that she liked, but she never stops in the whole tape. So it's just one big long song, switches keys and everything. It's just a giant medley. It's really, really neat. But she didn't tell any of my family what a lot of the melodies were. Like, no one of us knew what a lot of these songs were. So I used to go back and listen to that tape and try to figure out which songs are which. One of the songs that she did was called Limehouse Blues, and it's a very, very commonly done song. Me and my band, the Virginia Creepers, do it a lot. But the reason I want to do this song for y'all is because I can do some cross-picking with it. And it's a really neat song. I'm going to do it a little bit different than I normally do it just to show y'all some cross-picking. So the old style of cross-picking is down, down, up. That's the George Shuffler style. He played with the Stanley Brothers and was a really influential guitar player. And then the second type of cross-picking that I do is called alternate cross-picking. And honestly, the main guy who started that is one of my heroes, Norman Blake. So I'm going to do a little bit of both for you. So I'm going to kick off the song doing Down, Down, Up, the old George Shuffler style, and then I'm going to move into some alternate picking if I'm lucky. We'll see what happens, guys. Let's see if I can go back. Thank y'all so much. So, at the end of the day, how do I apply all this nonsense I've been talking about? Well, I'm about to show y'all here. This is an original tune, and maybe one day I'll come back again and do another workshop, and I can do a vocal workshop and talk more about singing. Because that's a big part of my performance too is the singing, and I'd like to talk a lot about yodeling too, eventually, and how I got started into that, but I don't really have time for that. But I will talk about how these guitar styles, you can influence them in your songwriting. So, you know, I take all these heroes in mind when I'm writing songs, and I'm gonna play y'all a funny little tune. That's a comical tune. I wrote it for the purpose of just the comical value of it, but it's an easy song to demonstrate different types of guitar picking. And so that's why I'm going to do this tune. And plus, it's just a pretty fun tune. It's one I wrote about my dad. He passed away when I was 12 from cancer, and he was a big inspiration to me as far as getting into music. They had a bluegrass band come to his funeral, and they played at his funeral, and it really inspired me to start playing. And my dad was a huge storyteller, and of course I had all his stories accumulated, and I wanted to, you know, write them into something musical, you know. And so I started writing down some of these stories, and this is one of my favorite stories. So my dad didn't get to go hunting when he was a little kid. His mom wouldn't let him, and she was really strict on him. And then when he got to be about 17 or something like that, after his mom had passed away, he finally got to go hunting. And he was hunting one time, and he had to use the restroom. And so he goes, and he squats down by a tree, and he grabs some leaves and uses the restroom, and everything gets done. Goes back home, well, his butt started itching. And you guys can already guess where this is going. So anyway, come to find out, you're not supposed to use poison ivy to wipe your ass. And he did. So I wrote this tune about it. It's called the Poison Ivy Song, and hope y'all get a kick out of it, and I'll do some fun guitar stuff on there. When I was just a boy, my daddy told me, son, there's some things I gotta teach you about this world. Well, he taught me how to be tough, and he taught me how to live when it's rough, and he taught me how to be a gentleman and how to treat the girls. But the most important thing that he taught me was how to grow up and be a man. The most important thing that he taught me, oh yes, was never wipe that ass with poison ivy. Now one day daddy was telling me that he was hunting way back in the 70s, and he was having a good old time with all his friends. So he sat down by a tree, and he grabbed them leaves of three. He started wiping, well, y'all can guess the rest. Yes, the most important thing that he taught me was how to grow up and be a man. Yes, the most important thing that he taught me was never wipe that ass with poison ivy. Thank you. So he got back from his trip, and he cracked a beer, and he took a sip, and he let out a holler that could be heard around the world. Oh! So he got some cream at the store. Well, hell, that just made it itch more. And there's a story about a boy who was awfully sore. Well, the most important thing that he taught me was how to grow up and be a man. Well, the most important thing that he taught me was never wipe your ass with poison ivy. The most important thing that he taught me was how to grow up and be a man. Well, the most important thing that he taught me was never wipe that ass with poison ivy. Oh, yes. Well, never wipe your ass with poison ivy. Thank y'all so much. I realized I didn't elaborate as much on Doc as I wanted to. Of course, I talked about Doc Watson, but his flat picking is very unique, and what makes it so unique, you know? You have Tony Rice, who's amazing and unique, and he wanted to be very, very different from other flat pickers and have his own sound. Unfortunately, everybody on Earth tries to copy him, and that's why I never tried to copy Tony Rice or steal from that, because I feel like he had such a unique and thing that it's just, it's very respectable. But Doc Watson, he was like the yin and yang to Tony. You know, Tony, he was all about syncopation and all about filling in space that needed fill, and all about attacking a note. You know, Tony would talk about attacking a note. You know, you can take one note, a D note, and you hit it one way and it sounds like this. You hit it another way, it sounds like, you hit it another way, it sounds like. You know, you can do so much with one note, and that's what he was all about. But Doc, he was more about just the straightforward, laying it out flat and heavy for you. And his flat picking is very concise and clean and very pungent. And so I'm going to do a little instrumental and try to play it kind of Doc Watson style, which is a lot of alternating, a lot of notes like that, and a lot of single string stuff. And then he would do the... He would do that Don Reno thing, too, because he loved Don. But here's a little demonstration. Here's one of my favorite tunes, and I actually learned a lick that off of this tune from David Greer. And I know he plays this tune, but it's just such a daggone good flat-picking tune that I got to at least give y'all my rendition of it. It's called the Beaumont Rag. Or as Clarence White called it, Julius Finkbein's Rag. That's what the Kentucky Colonels called it. I remember being about 12 or 13, right when I started getting into bluegrass, right? And I watched the video of Doc Watson doing this for like some type of a workshop type setting. And I thought to myself, if I can ever play that song on guitar, then I'll have made it, you know? And it took me years and years and years to get all the things, because this has cross picking in it. And it's also a rag. So in other words, it was played on piano originally. And so you gotta have the bounce with it too. You know, you gotta have the bounce. I could almost imagine my grandmother playing this song and, you know, her hitting all the good bass notes and adding in the fills up high, you know. And it's such a fun tune, and I hope y'all enjoy it. It goes little. Here's the David lick here. Right. Mm-hmm. Thank y'all so much. That feels so cool playing that song on this stage. I got time for one more song, and so I'll reiterate once again, I'm so happy to be at this festival. You have to come catch my band, the Virginia Creepers, over at the porch stage. If y'all think that I'm good, then just wait to hear the band, because I'm the smallest piece of the pie in that pie right there. There's some very talented musicians, and proud to call them my friends, and proud to have them in my band. I highly assure you, if you enjoyed this, then you will really enjoy seeing my band. And I just want to thank Suwannee for having me down here and to do this, because this has been so fun. And I want to thank y'all most all for being such a great audience and hanging out with me. So we're going to wrap it up with one here. I know Mr. Rowan's going to be playing here soon, and he's one of my all-time heroes, so I'm gonna do this one in honor of him. Paint 'em all red, paint 'em all red. They'll steal your woman, then rob your head. Paint 'em all red, paint 'em all red. On his white horse, Mescalito, he goes breezing through town. I'm just glad that I ain't dead. Got my good gal up in bed. She got me talking all out of my head. Oh, paint 'em all red. Well, everybody knows Panama Ritz back in town. Well, everybody knows it likes to keep well hidden underground. And my woman said, hey, Pedro, why you acting like a clown? Because nobody feels like working. Panama Ritz back in town. Panama Ritz, Panama Ritz. He'll steal your woman, then he'll rob your head. Panama Ritz, Panama Ritz. On his white horse, Mescalito, he goes breezing through town. Bet your woman's up in bed. She got him talking out of his head. And I'm glad that I ain't dead. I'm smoking that Panama Red. Everybody knows old Reddy satisfies, and the women love to sit and listen to him tell sweet lies. Well, I tell you what, baby, you're better off in bed, cause things can get confusing when you're messing with Panama Red. Panama Red, Panama Red. Well, you'll steal your woman, then he'll rob your head. Panama Red, Panama Red. Mescalito, he goes breezing through town. Got my woman up in bed. I'm glad that I ain't dead. Got me talking all out of my head. Oh, Panama Red. Yeah, Panama Red, Panama Red. He'll steal your woman, then he'll rob your head. Panama Red, on his white horse Mescalito, he goes breezing through town. Bet your woman's up in bed, and got him talking out of his head. And I'm glad that I ain't dead. I wish I was smoking that good old Panama Red. Thank y'all so much. Okay, I could do that real quick in the microphone. I'll do a yodel just real quick. Well, yodel-ay-oo, yodel-ay-oo, Catch us at the porch stage at 4:45.